Cloud, Todd, we can't see you.
See the top of my head. Your screen.
Todd has got a haircut too.
So we're going to start here. Is this when yours is on, Ron?
No.
No.
That's Phil.
Phil?
Phil, yeah.
You want to tell us about it, Phil?
It's just that I was afraid there'd be nobody to show anything to.
And I appreciate you bringing something. Because
this is an old, old piece that was done for, I don't remember who this was done for, but it's just an art. It's just a music piece. It has no meaning whatsoever.
Okay. So we have a new member here, Pat, correct?
Right.
He joined on Saturday.
Yeah.
And everything. Yeah.
Welcome.
Welcome.
So I reeled him in. I told him all kind of lies about our group and everything. We know everything and can fix anything.
I don't want to go that far.
Okay.
I know nothing.
that's it. That's
great.
Or some kind of a heart. I don't know what it was.
For how long have you gotten it? You got to go back to
10 years ago.
Yeah, the graph, the way that it slid through there and stuff, it's just interesting that, you know, the technology is.
It was done long, long time ago, and it was for some art.
Did she do the painting?
Yeah, it's all her.
Yeah, because I used to live next door. So.
You're kidding.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
It was done for somebody else for her.
She was really into art.
The art was beautiful.
Oh, yeah. I thought her work was.
Yeah. So those were paintings, or was it a book, or how?
No, they were supplied to me as
paper.
Yeah, on paper, yeah. But I don't remember exactly. It wasn't a book.
She used to do kids' books, too.
I think that was a kid, from a kid's book.
Okay. So, Phil, how did you do it?
John Ford said, with a camera.
I just was wondering. But seriously, when you have something moving across, was that basically a stop frame where you had to take?
Oh, no, that's all just electronically manipulated. I don't even remember what, this so long ago, I don't remember what software even I was. I just saw that on a file and I thought, well, nobody shows up on some shit.
But we did, and we like it. It was good stuff.
One of the reasons I ask is for our Egypt video, I was thinking of having, you know, a little boat go down the Nile River. And I wasn't sure what a good way to do that was, other than take, you know, like a couple of dozen frames where I moved the boat a tiny bit.
What are you working on?
DaVinci.
Well, yeah. That was all done with Photoshop originally, because those are all cutouts. Uh-huh. So, you know, you're taking her base plates and then taking the figures, cutting them out in Photoshop very carefully, and then animating. But that's what you can do.
Well, also with DaVinci, what you can do is, I forget particular part of DaVinci right now. I'll get it for you and everything. But you can put like the boat on there and then draw the line, and it'll just move right down the line.
Yeah. Oh, really?
Yes. Yeah, I've used that.
And After Effects. Mm-hmm. I don't know if anybody uses that, but it's the best program on earth. But it'll do all this stuff and animate. I mean, you can get the women could be waving their hands and doing all kinds of stuff.
So how did you at one section there, you put several figures in there, and you added, so you just did one at a time, put them in?
Well, they were all cutouts. They were all taken out in Photoshop and then pieced back together. I'm guessing it's been so long. And then put it in an editor. Well, actually, I think I used another program that I don't use anymore. That was an animation program. I don't even remember the name of it.
But yeah, you can do that on Premiere Elements.
You can do this on anything.
Move stuff.
I have another film which we won't show, and which was a thing I shot in Europe, where I wanted boats to move up the river. Like, I just thinking about that, and all I did was took the boat out, created a plate behind it, and animated. So the boat's coming up to on a lake in Italy, and the boat's coming up, and it looks okay. It looks fake, but you get the idea.
All right. Before we go on to the next video, so Pat, you didn't see anything?
That's correct. I didn't see the video nor the audio.
Huh?
You did click share screen.
So you got to look at us the whole time, huh?
And it said Gary.
Yeah, you guys looked intense.
We were awestruck.
I seem to recall Kevin did a share screen after he brought it up or something.
Well, it said up at the top that it was
Jerry.
Yeah.
And green.
I saw your desktop.
Oh, okay.
Oh, did you share the whole desktop instead of just the window?
Well, Kevin usually has the movie playing on his desktop while it's playing.
Well, it was playing on mine. Well, I'm not sure, Pat, what
it looked like it was working.
It shows, I mean, it's showing that we're sharing screen here. And share. Anything there is going to change anything.
Todd, do you have the screen duplicated or extended?
Pardon
me?
Well, the basic setting, I mean.
In Windows, do you have it set to that the TV duplicates what's on your screen? Probably, because you're looking at the same thing on your screen that you're seeing on the...
Yes.
Okay. No, I don't think that's it. That's, I think that's the video it's taking of recording.
With Zoom, who knows?
Yeah.
I know what you're saying. The basic computer settings.
Yeah,
but you have several options. But,
yeah,
one of ports.
You know, sometimes I do extended where what's showing on the TV screen is different from it.
Yeah,
it's like basically having a two-screen system, but that's not what's happening here. Hit the share screen again. Oh wait, did you have to? You just minimized something, and I'm not sure what you did.
Well, I was bringing up the next video.
Yeah, but you I don't understand what you minimized. I wonder if you had one screen on top of another or something like that.
So this is where I have all the videos for today.
Yeah.
And I can see your desktop.
So you see the five videos?
Correct.
Well, then he's hit play.
Well, let's try this then. Ron, you're the Indian powwow, right?
You're right.
You want to tell us about that?
Yeah, down Tombstone, they have an Indian powwow. This was the fourth year. Indians come from like Montana, Illinois, and Arizona. It wasn't a large group, but it was still wonderful.
Indians from Illinois. Sounds like a movie title.
Can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming?
This is Anjali's interpretation of the Native American boot dance, and we're very proud that she is the first full-blood Hopi Native American boot dancer. Let's give her a big round of applause. Mr. Ryan Polikwapua.
Tombstone, I can't hear ya!
All right. Thank you.
Go ahead.
Pretty interesting.
Excuse me, there's no way to clean up the wind.
It's called a windsock.
Yeah.
Did you increase the speed at all?
No.
God, that girl is phenomenal.
Yeah. And the two guys that were dancing were the one in the middle had his regular cloak on.
Yeah.
They were the original line dancers, right?
And he,
there you go.
He couldn't wear his uniform because he put so much weight on. And the interesting thing with that dance is they have competitions, and their feet have to all synchronize at the same time, and that's whoever does the best job. And, you know, if you happen to watch their feet, they work out.
When was this?
About 3-4 weeks ago now.
I would have liked to see a close-up of one of those kids' faces. You know what?
Yeah.
Close shot.
Yeah.
Well, I'm just surprised to see Hopis, because the Hopis don't do this kind of stuff in public. Yeah. They just don't.
But on the comment on eliminating wind noise, it is possible to do it in Audacity. Because my daughter works at a community college in Saskatchewan, and they've got a lot of First Nations people there, to the extent that they have First Nations elders to, support the students going through. So they had an elder that did a talk, and whoever shot the video didn't know about windsocks or you know, dead cats. And I was able to clean it up amazingly well. You know,
if it's pretty steady, it works real well.
Yeah, well,
if it's not, it's not so good.
Well, you just grab a bite, it's just some wind.
Right.
And then you just keep cutting it down, you know, several times, time after time on the same clip. And I got to the point where it was intelligible.
What do you mean cutting it down?
Oh,
Audacity learns from the right?
Yeah. You take a segment of the clip that is just wind noise.
Okay.
And you tell Audacity, this is the noise I want to remove, or these frequencies. So then you hit the whole thing and say, do this. And if it doesn't come enough, say, do it again. And you can control the percentage that you drop it down as well. But just keep cutting it until you can do it. Obviously, it's going to impact the sound you want to hear, too. But all you're trying to do is get the other one up there. It's the edge one.
For things like 60 cycle, hum works perfect.
Yeah.
It's just it's gone.
So I had done an interview with a gentleman, one of my neighbors, and I did this over a several week period. He had stage 4 cancer, and I didn't notice it at the time. But from the time I started till the time I end, his voice kept getting weaker and weaker and weaker. The problem I found out that I had was that the air conditioning system would kick on. And then sometimes the hum from the air conditioning system, especially in the end, I really couldn't barely even hear him and everything. So I played around in Audacity trying to take out that sound, but I wasn't successful at it.
Did you try playing with the equalizer and the DaVinci?
This was just an audio recording.
Oh.
It wasn't video.
You can still do it in DaVinci.
Yeah.
Well, I can try that. Load it into DaVinci and see.
But Audacity
has better tools than DaVinci.
I'll pay you back.
Well, that was with the camera sound. I didn't take my mic along, which I should have, because I thought that was hot.
The drum beats were amazingly good.
Yeah.
And you were a ways away.
Yeah.
Were you able to move around freely? Could have you moved to some different positions?
But there were so many people around that where I was probably as good as anywhere.
So, and Ron was telling me, before everyone else got here, that one of the clips is when you saw the older gentleman out there dancing with the very elaborate robe on and everything, how the focus was going in and out. He was,
I saw that.
Autofocus has real troubles.
And I was set at about 40 millimeters. If I would have used a little bit wider, but I was trying to keep the people large enough, you know, so they.
Oh, it was the autofocus was just deciding it didn't want to work right.
Yeah.
All righty. Okay, let's see. Our next.
Ask Pat if he saw that.
Yeah, he did. He said
he did see it.
I saw the video.
Okay. All right. So the next one here is going to be Larry's Soaring in the Canadian Rockies.
Yeah, Doug asked me to show this.
Yep. You're doing this for Doug.
That's the reason. Yeah. it's something.
Do you do everything Doug asked you to do?
Almost. He carries a rifle around.
But I like the idea of showing some of your old stuff. Watch it all.
Yeah. The Canadian Rockies are always spectacular.
The Canadian Rockies are always spectacular, but to be able to fly over them adds another dimension, both literally and figuratively. I flew my sailplane out of a soaring site on the west side of the Rockies in British Columbia. The first requirement is to put the glider together. We call it rigging the glider. The wings are inserted into the fuselage. And secured with two pins. The last control component to attach is the elevator. It's a relatively quick and easy procedure. After pushing my glider onto the runway, I was prepared to take off. Since the glider has only one wheel, a line buoy levels my wings, and away I go. The beeping you hear is an instrument telling me that I am gaining altitude, a sound I will look for and hope to hear after I have released. I pull my release, turn away from the tow plane, and I'm on my own. Just like this Osprey. I climb up above the mountaintops. Off to my right are the Rocky Mountains as I head north along the mountain ridge. Cloud base is low, so near Radium Hot Springs, I turn around and head south. To my left is Swan Lake Provincial Park, so named because the lake is in the shape of a swan. Continue south, past Premier Lake, and a mountain ridge called the Steeples, on my way down to the U.S. border, 185 kilometers or 110 miles south of Invermere. After turning around at that point and returning to the Invermere area, I headed west into the Purcell Mountains for some flight seeing. Then crossed back over to the east side of the Columbia River Valley. To descend along that mountain ridge. Flight must now end as I enter the circuit to land at the Invermere Airport.
Invermere traffic. Glider Sierra 1 entering the circuit for right-hand downwind, runway 15. Invermere traffic. Glider Sierra 1. turning right base and final, runway 15. Gravity once more. Invermere traffic. Glider Sierra 1, clear of the active.
I wondered like you did to keep the wings from dragging on the cement, and you went to the grass.
Yeah, yeah.
Otherwise, you don't want it right at the end.
Well, there's a, on that glider, there was a fiberglass that went down, had a metal piece in the middle of it, so it wasn't a problem that way, but it was mainly just to clear the runway.
Yeah. How long, time-wise, were you in the air?
At a guess, half. Maybe 2 hours, 3 hours, something like that.
Jeez. There were some clouds. Aren't you ever worried about the storms?
Well, you can see what's coming. You can see. You learn to look at, you know, read clouds.
Right. Yep.
You see puffy ones, and you get underneath them and climb up. In this case, you know, I'm flying along the Rockies, so you've got a wind over the west that hits the Rockies, and the air goes up.
You
get on that, but that's what it's a good place to fly.
So, how many on your crew? How many? Assembling people.
Well, I just needed one person, that one guy.
Okay.
Yeah. And somebody to hold the wing when we push it out onto the runway. And then a line boy to hold the wing tip until you are going fast enough to be able to keep the wings level.
Yeah.
How many people can fly?
Big bird.
How many people can fly in the plane?
Just me. Just one. Yeah, that's a single place. There are two, place trainers. That's a racing glider, was back in those days.
How much distance would you have covered in that 2 hours?
Well, it was 100-odd kilometers down to the ridge. I think it said there. Yeah, it was a short flight relative in distance. My longest flight ever was 1,000 kilometers. It was in Pennsylvania on the Allegheny Ridge. And on that same ridge there, I set a Canadian speed record of speed to a goal over 100 kilometer flight of 125 kilometers an hour. But it didn't last very long, so I didn't beat it up. Wave flights.
So what kind of camera were you using?
A GoPro.
Did you have it mounted on you or on?
No, it was on the top of the instrument panel. I just drilled a hole through it, put a 1/4-20 bolt through and held it there. Mm-hmm. And I could also rotate it as I was flying to get the mountains out to the left.
You ever have the checkers pants?
Sorry?
That just scares me so much.
Well, that's what every power pilot says. And I say to them, what do you practice most? It's engine failure. Well, in a glider, you don't have anything. It's pretty simple.
It's just flying mountain.
So you just get to practice it all the time, right?
But if you're missing your approach, you can't go.
It's right there, yeah. You make sure you get a shot. That's why you have spoilers.
It's beautiful.
You didn't see them, but they come up out of the wing, and it increases your drag.
So yeah, but in an airplane, spoilers have a dual meaning.
Well, in light aircraft that don't have spoilers, then you would side slip in. You know, it's the same thing, lose altitude.
Yeah, once you're set up on that approach, that's not a big deal.
Is there any place around here you can do that?
Yeah, just north of Tucson, El Tiro Glider Port.
Yeah, they fly out there almost every day.
Yeah, I flew there the first year I came down here in 97 and never brought my glider back again because just one of the things we wanted to do. It wasn't that great in the winter time.
You want to see them go on the weekend. They're there almost every weekend.
Well, where's that at?
Is that Marana?
Yeah.
Outside Marana.
Oh, yeah.
El Tyro.
Yep.
The, I'm trying to think of it. Ragged Top, is that the mountain there?
That's the mountain.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Just under there.
Know it well. So is there a heater in there in your plane?
No.
No?
No, you just dress. That's one.
Yeah.
But down here, that's generally not a problem. You know, the problem used to be when I'd come down in the summertime and I'd fly out of Nevada or Utah, and my wife was left on the ground in the camper that wasn't plugged in, so the air conditioner didn't work, and I'm up at 10,000 feet, just delightful.
Rena finally said, no more crewing, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah. 1987.
All right.
I had to get another crew.
Yeah. Well, thanks for sharing that with us, Larry.
Yeah. Fun to look at it again.
All right.
Can you still have pay to go on a glider with another
person? Oh, yes. Yeah, yeah. And any glider club generally will do that. And that one is, it's a club, but I'm sure they'll do it. And there's another one up at Estrella near Eloy, which is definitely a commercial operation.
Thank you.
Is there a battery for your instruments?
Yes. Yeah, for sure. Yeah. And my son sells gliders and glider equipment now, and the instrumentation that he sells is, you know, thousands of dollars. You know, my glider, when I bought it, was only $35,000. He's got one that's $100,000, another is $250,000. So they're high tech stuff.
What do you pay for the toll?
Back in those days, probably $25. Yeah.
Well, that's pretty big, though.
Yeah. Because it's a club.
Okay.
And the place I was flying was a commercial operation, but I'm sure I didn't pay much more than $25.
And you decide when you want to release.
Yep. Yeah. If the glider does something unreasonable, the tow pilot has a release, too.
So, but after you release, that line just
he lands with it on, yeah.
Unless he gets it wrapped around a power line, which has
hopefully they have a weak link on it, so
yeah,
it grabs something, it
breaks off.
Yeah.
You know, if you're ever in Colorado Springs, check out the Air Force Academy, because that's the way most of the Air Force pilots start.
Yeah,
is in gliders.
Well, I flew out of Boulder one summer or one time. Yeah.
You're a new Green Valley Recreation member and new to the Green Valley area. So where do you go if you're interested in digital photography? You need to make tracks to the Recreation Village at Santa Rita Springs, just off the I-19 East Frontage Road. There, you'll find the GVR Photography Club, located on the east side, second level of the Santa Rita Springs Recreation Center. Our club is one of the largest in the country. Whatever digital device you use, whether it's a camera, a smartphone, tablet, action camera, or drone, the GVR Photography Club is the place you need to be. The club's focus is on education, both formal and informal. Classes for novice photographers include fundamentals of photography, composition, photo editing, organizing your photos, printing and mounting photographs, and slide and video show production. We can also show you how to set up your digital device so you can take full advantage of your equipment. More advanced courses include Photoshop, Creative Suite, and Lightroom, as well as multimedia production. Classes on taking photographs with smartphones and other digital devices are also offered. The class leaders are all very knowledgeable and helpful. Many have backgrounds as commercial photographers, videographers, and college instructors. They'll take the time to ensure you not only understand, but can apply the materials being taught. Classes and workshops are conducted in person at the club, online via Zoom, or a blended method which combines online with hands-on instruction. By the way, all our courses, classes, and workshops are free to club members. If you want to do a deep dive into a particular aspect of photography or videography, you're certain to learn a lot through one of our special interest groups, or SIGs. As a club member, you can participate in as many SIGs as you want. One of the most popular things the club offers to its members are the many field trips we conduct between October and April each year. Whether you're interested in the region's arts, crafts, and rich history, trips to the area's birding and nature hotspots, unique cultural festivals and regional holidays, the really interesting folks and cool critters you meet along the way, and, of course, the Wild Wild West. Our field trips provide a fantastic opportunity for you to get out and hone your picture-taking skills, compare notes and share photos with others on your trip, learn about the area from our volunteer guides, and have a ton of fun in the process. In the old days, you had to rely on someone else to process your photos. These days, you're in complete control using the club's post-production software. So what do you do with those photo albums, videos, 35mm slides, and 8mm home movies you already have? If you're like most GVR members, you probably downsized from your previous residence when you moved here. You may have brought a lifetime of photographs, slides, and videos, many inherited from family and friends. So what can you do with all those photos, videos, slides, and home movies when you no longer have room for them? And who's going to get what pictures when the time comes for you to pass them along? We can help you easily resolve these challenges. The club's state-of-the-art equipment enables you to convert those photos, slides, and videos into digital format. For example, our photo scanner can not only scan a photograph every second, but can also produce the original and a digitally enhanced version of each picture. If there are notes on the back of the photo, that's not a problem. The photo scanner will capture that information as well. You can also convert your 35mm slides, film, and analog videotapes to digital format using the club's equipment. And once you've gone digital, you'll no longer have to worry about who gets what photos. You can create a digital photo and video library that you can easily share with family and friends. Many of our members create thumb drives containing photos and videos to give as presents at family gatherings and class reunions. You can make large format prints of your photographs. Our printers can produce images up to 17 by 22 inches. And we have all the necessary supplies and equipment so you can mat and frame your finished photographs. The club provides many opportunities for you to show off your photography and multimedia skills. Showtime enables members to display short slide or multimedia presentations of their work to club and other GVR members. Club members are invited and encouraged to submit their programs. It's easy. Take some of your photos or videos from a field trip or other event and put them into a program. We'll show you how. It's the best free entertainment in Arizona. Many of our club members are avid travelers, and the rest of us love to hear about their journeys. So it's only natural we host a specialized form of Showtime focused entirely on travel and vacation adventures. Travelogue literally takes you around the world. Enjoy great photography and pick up important travel tips in the process. If you're interested in exhibiting still images, you've come to the right place. Throughout the year, there are opportunities to display your photographs at the club and at major GVR centers. We use the club's Facebook page, as well as the club's large screen monitor, to exhibit our members' digital photographs. Don't be shy. Take advantage of the opportunity to show off your work and your passion for photography. The club's speaker series features outstanding presentations by locally, nationally, and internationally known photographers, videographers, and other visual artists. The speaker series provides an opportunity to understand the presenter's motivation, their approach to their craft, and often provides a peek into the process of creating these masterful works of art. The speaker series is conducted in the winter and spring months. It's held in conjunction with the club's monthly membership meeting, which is open to all GVR members. The club and its members are often asked to provide photographic and multimedia support for special events, as well as local civic and nonprofit organizations. Not only does this give you a chance to exercise and expand your skills, but also provides you a meaningful way to use your talents to give back to the community. The opportunity to serve others and the spirit of volunteerism are defining characteristics of the Green Valley area. And one of the key things that makes our community so special. You can keep up with club activities on our website, on our Facebook page, and through our monthly newsletter. Stop by the Photography Club in the Santa Rita Springs Recreation Center to learn about all the other fun and interesting things you can do as a Photography Club member. Come make friends and photographs.
You know, and the intent for that one is when Gene does his 10-week winter course, that'll kind of be the overview. But as we've talked about a lot here, is it's too way too long.
Really?
I mean, according to a lot of people. So what we've done is take the lead and the closing and sandwich in chunks of that video. So the next one that we've got is a sample of that.
You're a new Green Valley Recreation member and new to the Green Valley area. So where do you go if you're interested in digital photography? You need to make tracks to the Recreation Village at Santa Rita Springs, just off the I-19 East Frontage Road. There, you'll find the GVR Photography Club, located on the east side, second level of the Santa Rita Springs Recreation Center. Our club is one of the largest in the country. The club provides many opportunities for you to show off your photography and multimedia skills. Showtime enables members to display short slide or multimedia presentations of their work to club and other GVR members. Club members are invited and encouraged to submit their programs. It's easy. Take some of your photos or videos from a field trip or other event and put them into a program. We'll show you how. It's the best free entertainment in Arizona. Many of our club members are avid travelers, and the rest of us love to hear about their journeys. So it's only natural we host a specialized form of Showtime focused entirely on travel and vacation adventures. Travelog literally takes you around the world. Enjoy great photography and pick up important travel tips in the process. If you're interested in exhibiting still images, you've come to the right place. Throughout the year, there are opportunities to display your photographs at the club and at major GVR centers. We use the club's Facebook page, as well as the club's large screen monitor, to exhibit our members' digital photographs. Don't be shy. Take advantage of the opportunity to show off your work and your passion for photography. Stop by the Photography Club in the Santa Rita Springs Recreation Center to learn about all the other fun and interesting things you can do as a Photography Club member. Come make friends and photographs.
That's a little teaser.
Yeah. So that's about a minute and a half. And if need be, we can shorten it up even more.
And
I kind of lean on Phil as far as, you know, what people will tolerate before they just go start tuning out. So if we need to.
To me, the short one is all you need. people don't want to sit there and keep
unless
going.
We're forced to sit in the class, right?
but even like the show time, if you want to show it, I think the shorter one is.
Oh yeah, really yeah. I wouldn't dare do the long version.
Yeah.
For any of our special events, no. You know, except for the, and actually what we did for this weekend was we had the long version, but we also had the teasers. So, and they just loop throughout the course of the open house.
We're doing at the
market.
At the market, we have a booth there. The shorter version of the laptop running at the market would be great.
Or even the long one with the subtitles too, you know, just stick on a loop.
Okay.
And the first one is Wednesday.
This Wednesday?
What?
This Wednesday?
Yep.
Yeah, I'm doing the first Wednesday in January.
I'm doing the first Wednesday in December.
Yeah, if you want, I could do what I did for this weekend for the open house and just set it up where you have each one of the teaser videos
mm-hmm.
just running along and then it loops back.
It'd be good to have it there.
Yeah, because Monica had the field trip teaser out front of the table and everything, and it seemed like that got quite a bit of attention.
Yeah.
The one that we really need to work up a teaser on are the SIGs. Because I only had that one shot of a portrait, you know, studio session and everything. And when I was in here looking at what was on display, you know, we could do some pretty powerful stuff with a fairly short video. You know, the one where they do Photoshop and they take the Native American and their tribal garb, and there's a bunch of spectators just jamming up the shot, and then the next thing you see is a clean shot of the Native American in his dress and a clean background, and it's like the difference is night and day. And if we can show things like that, you know, that black and white photography and the other SIGs, I think that would be a huge seller for the club.
So the battery on the laptop lasts for 4 hours?
No, I had it plugged in.
No, I'm asking for the farmer's market.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. My battery will.
So there's no electricity there?
No.
There's only electricity at select booths, and I won't know where we're going to set up until that morning. So most likely it'd have to be.
You can take my laptop if you can.
Battery.
Put it on a thumb drive for me. I'll play it when I'm there. But I don't need it for another month. So.
Okay. But you'll need it.
I'll need it. I can bring my laptop.
Okay. Yeah, what time does that start?
9.
Oh, okay.
9 to 1.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, I'll be in down here tomorrow morning for one of the field trips. And I can just put it, you got a folder, right, Sam?
Yep.
Yeah, I'll just take a thumb drive and put it in your folder and everything tomorrow.
Well, actually, aren't I meeting with you?
Wednesday. Yeah, but that's going to be like.
Oh, I thought it was Wednesday. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Too late.
Yeah.
You can put it in there.
Okay. Either that, or I could do a WeTransfer and send it to you that way.
We could try that and see how big it is.
Yeah, how big is the file? You know?
I bought a subscription to WeTransfer, so size doesn't matter.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll just take probably forever to download the thing. So
what do we do? It can take forever to download.
Yeah.
Well, you better just
let me just do a thumb drive and put it in your folder and everything tomorrow morning.
Okay.
All right. We'll make sure to stop by tomorrow.
Okay.
All right. Well, our time is up. Does anyone have anything else I want to add to it? Well, nope. Thank you. Thanks for putting up with my couple stumbles here.
It's all good,
Todd. Yeah, that's right.
For sure.
Are you doing the show tomorrow I mean, Wednesday, are you going to be there?
Oh, yeah, I'm there.
Okay.
Yes, because I get everything set up.
Okay.
At the farmer's market.
Okay.
Yeah. And then I'm with Chuck tonight at Showtime.
Where's the register?
You're a busy guy.
Yeah, busy this week.
Register.
Yeah. So, all right. Pat, anything? Nope.
Nope. Thank you.
All right. Well, sorry about that screw up on the first one.
No problem.
Ruby Art looks nice.
All right. I'm going to end the recording here.